TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas. We're talking Mirrodin Besieged spoilers today, and before you get a word in, I'm to the 21st century. No more giant stacks of paper for cards. I've got right on my droid here.
I've got them all up here.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah.
Fire away, then. Who's first on our list to talk about?
It'd be Tezzeret, Agent of Bolas, because, you know, Planeswalker. I've got to talk about the only Planeswalker on the set.
One for one. All right. So far, so good. This guy, we might be able to do a whole show on this card. I think it's worth talking about.
It's certainly very interesting. He actually reminds me a lot of Sark and the Mad. If you actually look at their abilities, they're like very, very similar. The first one, they both draw you a card, although Tezzeret obviously just goes up in loyalty. And you have to have an artifact in the top five, which is obviously, you know, you're not going to want to play him in a deck that doesn't have a ton of artifacts. So it's just like plus one impulse, which is pretty nice.
Yeah, pretty sweet.
His minus one ability makes an artifact into a 5/5, whereas Sarkin makes it into a 5/5 dragon.
Similar, very similar.
Except you don't lose the artifact, so it still actually has its abilities and all that. And you can make your artifact creatures bigger, too. If you target a Memnite, it just becomes a 5/5 Memnite.
Yeah, and the nice thing is it's permanently. When I first glanced at it, I was kind of like, oh, you know, you can get in for 5.
No, it's not Angelic Blessing. It's permanent. So,
sweet.
And it also has haste. Or essentially, like, because if the artifact was already in play, you can attack with it. So imagine playing against a deck with Jace, and, you know, they go Jace Brainstorm, or even Jace Fate Seal, and you go Tezzeret, animate my untapped artifact, attack your Jace. Like, that's actually a huge tempo swing.
That's pretty sweet.
So that's pretty sweet. The disadvantage, of course, unlike Sarkhan, he can't kill your opponent's guys. But and then the last ability, probably his worst ability, where he gets to drain life them for X, where X is twice as many artifacts as you have. So.
Now, I mean, I'll agree with you that in most formats, the last ability is the worst. However, when I kind of looked at this card on the whole, the first thing I started to think was, are there vintage implications with this card?
Or like vintage legacy affinity type decks?
Oh, yeah.
Like artifact lands, all artifact creatures?
Well, talking about just like the basic Tezzeret deck in vintage right now, this guy could replace a copy of Jace or maybe even a copy of Tezzeret, depending on how things go.
No, like the thing is, I agree with what you're saying, that there's a potential for having this guy in Vintage or Legacy, but I think there's no way he's ever going to get near like a blue-black, like a blue control deck, because you're going to drain him for like six because you've got a couple Moxes in play. Like that's not exactly what the deck wants to do. Whereas
so many matches, it's like, don't die off my Confidant, or you're like, you have that under control, then it's like, don't die to my Mana Crypt.
Yeah,
like,
but
just
if,
activating that once
but if you had like
could be the game.
A Tezzeret instead, you can just get a Sensei Stop or something like that. Like, whereas this guy in Affinity, where he can drain life for 10 or 12 damage pretty easily, that's one thing, even though I still think that the Affinity wants less, more cheap spells. Maybe like one Tezzeret would be okay.
I mean, yeah, you can't Aether Vial this guy into play. Like, there's no...
Yeah.
I mean, he costs four. You can't cheat him out anyway, so... It could be a finisher. I mean, in that regard, you can't immediately just do it and run it.
Yeah.
That's why I thought maybe a control aspect would give him more an opportunity to shine.
Yeah, no, I think the most potential he's going to have is in Standard and Extended, looking at like an artifact value deck, which I'm hoping, you know, as it comes along in Standard, like I've said.
We've got some sweet ones. I mean,
yeah.
Already in the cards we've seen spoiled, like we're making moves forward to have
yeah.
artifacts more constructive.
I guess
playable.
Leading into another card, that'd be Phyrexian Revoker, a card I actually just wrote an article about.
Yeah, conveniently on my list today.
Which you can check out. And without repeating too much what I said there, it's like a good pithing needle for beatdown decks. Like, you're not going to want it in the same space as like when a control deck wants needle. Because playing one small guy doesn't really help your plan, because the damage he does doesn't combine well with like Grave Titan, for example, because Titan just kills them, and he's vulnerable to removal that would normally be dead out of their deck. But in a beatdown deck where we've got a ton of small guys, he's actually gonna be pretty good. He's just like a disruptive bear, like a Tidehall Sculler.
Yeah, it's pretty sweet, and I like the fact that he's more mid-range aggro, like compatible than control aggro. I mean, obviously, if they just reprinted Needle, you take your blue base control decks and you might play it. It does something. Here, you're not going to want it in a deck that plays Day of Judgment or Consume the Meter.
Right,
or
but
things like
it's
that.
Good in, like, if there, again, is an artifact beatdown deck sort of thing.
And how sweet is it? I mean, like, think about all the times you're playing with Needle right now. It's like, you draw the second one, you've named the problem, and now you have...
Yeah, I mean, I had that problem in the Legacy tournament where I Needled Aether Vial, and my opponent, you know, then I drew a second Needle and didn't really do my that much.
Right. Whereas, meanwhile, these guys is like, all right, just get in there more.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, so, and doubling up isn't so bad on the same card. He's got two ones. All right.
Speaking of artifacts and possibly vintage, Bladesteel Colossus is pretty sweet. He's one mana of the Darksteel Colossus to give him infect.
Which really, like, it's totally doesn't matter at this point. I mean, you could make him cost 800, and it doesn't.
Well, I've hardcast Darksteel Colossus before.
I have as well.
But
off of Cloud Post, off of Tolarian Academy.
Mostly Tolarian Academy, but I agree that the mana cost is not really an issue, so he's going to be better than Darksteel Colossus in pretty much any deck that wants to play Darksteel Colossus.
Those decks are few and far between right now.
Right, in Vintage, the big Tinker artifact of choice seems to be Mirror Battlesphere, but this guy, I mean, One-hit kill is pretty nice.
Yeah, not too much to scoff at. I mean, obviously, love the flavor. Yeah, love the feel.
I mean, Darksteel Colossus goes in and out of vintage decks fairly regularly, just depending on what else is going on. And this guy looks like he's just, you know, made Darksteel Colossus kind of obsolete.
Yeah, yeah. My foil ones already kind of took a hit when M10 came out. And
same.
and now we've got this guy, so I don't, yeah. So long, Darksteel Colossus. We'll miss you. It was good times.
But there are definitely some more sweet cards. Consecrated Sphinx is one that I know a lot of people have gotten excited about, which I think is interesting. So you play him and you pass the turn and immediately draw two cards if they don't have removal.
Okay.
And
then your opponent either kills it and the game continues, or they don't and you win the game, maybe?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if it's better than like a type, because that's obviously where the bar is for six mana guys right now. But, I mean, it's close. I don't think it fights that well against Jace. People are like, oh, Jace, they can't brainstorm. It's like, well, yeah, but they can bounce your six casting cost creature and then mana leak it or something.
What happened to Sphinx's having Shroud for like, a while? Like, come on.
Playing Sphinx, them untapping, you drawing two, them going, Jace, bounce your Sphinx, you replaying it, and you them mana leaking it, puts the advantage firmly on their side. So in that situation, if you're going to resolve a six drop, I'd rather resolve a Grave Titan. And that's... unfortunately, where the Sphinx is going to end.
Most I mean, it's like, oh, I drew two cards off of it, but you invested, like, what, 12 mana to get those two cards in two turns?
On the other hand, Sun Titan and Sphinx are, like, comparable in a blue-white deck, maybe. Like, instead of putting back in, like, you know, something small, you can get two cards. Though, putting back in Jace is pretty good, so Jace Beleren, of course.
Tectonic Hedge, Spreading Seas, Journey to Nowhere, Ratchet Bomb. The list goes on. Squadron Hawk.
So, yeah, I'm not 100% sure about that. The next card up is actually a cycle, which I think are going to be pretty good. So far we only have two of them, the Red Sun Zenith and the Green Sun Zenith.
Yes. One, I mean, it's sweet to me, like flavor-wise. We have a cycle very similar to the Beacons from 5th Dawn, a spell that's going to do something, and then you're going to shovel back into your deck.
So I'm trying to remember, were there five suns? There's all suns done, right? So it's five suns in the Mirrodin. So,
yeah, and there are five beacons. So,
and five colors.
And now apparently these five suns are crashing onto the planet or something. I don't really know.
No, Zenith is one of the suns at its highest.
Oh, really?
Not the lowest. But
didn't really pass astronomy or go to it. So yeah, sure. When it's at its peak, you get to fireball something and shuffle back
in. Well, the red
ones
fireball, shuffle back in, so not very good.
Limited only.
Yeah, I mean, going to be good and limited, obviously. Fireball always
right.
is.
Right, Titan's Revenge, only you're going to get it back in your deck somewhere for sure, as opposed to your hand.
But the green one's, I think, pretty sweet. Paulo actually wrote about how good it is, and you can obviously check out his article. He goes pretty in-depth. But I think the green one actually has a lot of potential. Just, I mean, again, adding one to mana cost to whatever it is you're getting in order to have like a ton of flexibility is pretty good.
Well, I mean, you played a card very similar at high-level tournaments.
Some respect?
Or Court of Calling.
Oh, Court of Calling. Well, some respect, probably a little bit more well-known because that was Berlin. But, that elf deck would have played this card, I think. Like, paying two mana for Nettle Sentinel or Heritage Druid or three mana for Elvish Visionary or two mana for Wirewood Symbiote is not that bad. And the fact that it can get any of them is pretty sweet. And you can get it ahead of time, whereas Summoner's Pact you can only cast when you go off. This you can just, like, you know, get a guy and then pass the turn.
So I mean, we're mostly talking about the bottom end. I mean, is there any reason to get a Primeval Titan with this guy?
Well, there is, because, again, shamelessly stealing from Paul's article, because, you know, he's the one who said it first, putting this in a Valakut deck, and so having a card that's three mana get Overgrown Battlement or seven mana get Primeval Titan, I mean, that's very good. Because now you've got another expensive drop that when you need a top deck an expensive spell, that's also a ramp spell. Like, having a split card of Overgrown Battlement Primeval Titan is, like, exactly what the deck wants. So, it can't get a Colony Heart Expedition, unfortunately. It can only get creatures, but that would be pretty sweet.
You could get Gaea's Revenge, you can get Avengers Endicar, once you get to the, you know, I have a million mana, but I'm not playing
the
game. The
thing is, spells that are good when you have a million mana and good when you only have three mana are very good. That's the reason that, like, modular spells that just, like, go ramp up are really good, because... you want spells that are good early and good late. That's just what a good spell is.
So the fireball ones are no good?
Yeah, but fireball's not good early or really late. Yeah, is the problem.
Deal two, deal seven.
Yeah.
Okay. So I mean, where do we go from here on my sweet spoiler list? Do you know?
I mean, there's some other cards we haven't talked about. Phyrexian Rebirth, white-white four, destroy all creatures, and then you get a guy who's as big as the number of creatures you destroyed. The new Kirtar's Wrath or Martial Coup or...
March of Souls or any of these.
The white sorceries that destroy things and give you a creature, which I'm not like incredibly excited about this card. Like, I think it's pretty sweet, but I really wish, I mean, Marshall Coup is better, basically, is what I'm trying to say. It's like again, like looking at it in the context of Standard, it's like they play a Grave Titan, you slam this down. I mean, you have like a 3-3. You have a 6-mana 3-3 that killed their board, which is good. I mean, you answered Grave Titan. That's always a good thing. But then if they play Jace, they can just bounce your token. Like,
right.
If you had 3-1-1s or 3-2-2s even, that would be sweet.
Yeah, that's the immediate thing is it's like, you know, anything that's going to make one guy in a format where Jace is
pretty. I mean, as much as I like Jace, and I've activated Jace many, many times, Jace does not have a healthy effect on a lot of cards in the format. So.
Well, I mean, I looked at it and immediately thought, okay, block. Maybe.
Yeah.
Because, like, we kind of have our first, like, Wrath effect for block.
Yeah, I mean, that is important. I mean,
there was Elspeth before, but it wasn't quite, you know, we're used to a sorcery that wipes the board. And now we have one, so,
yeah.
You know, maybe adding a little bit more to White's package.
Thinking about it as, like, a 6-mana, like, 3-3 or 4-4 creature, just like a Desolation Giant, is not that bad. Like, I think the card is interesting and certainly powerful, so
it's kind of like a preemptive Sunblast Angel. It's kind of how I thought about it, too. Like,
it's like a Sunblast Angel that takes a little less work, but also kills your guys.
Right, and it may or may not be as good as a 4-5.
Yeah, probably not. 4-5 flyers can be tough to beat, but
okay.
Speaking of cards that beat Jace, we have Thrun the Last Troll, which is a really sweet name, by the way.
Yeah, no more trolling. This is it. This is the last of it. It's all done.
But I like trolling you.
Among many, yeah. Yes.
So he's pretty good. He is one of the cards that, you know, supposed to beat Jace that actually beats Jace in the sense that Jace can't do anything against him.
Right. Like can't touch this guy.
No, I mean, you play him, they can't counter him, they can't target him, they can't bounce him with Jace, which is like the main drawback of these cards, you know. And, I mean, yeah, Jace can plus two to survive for a turn, and then you can throw guys in the way, but, I mean, when he comes in, he just, like, every turn. He's a lot better than Troll Ascetic. I always thought Troll Ascetic was terrible. I think...
Always.
I've never thought that card was good in any format. But this guy... is actually good. He's bigger than Troll Ascetic, so you don't have to regenerate him when it fights anything. That's one of the problems with Troll. It's also uncounterable, which is, I think, pretty important. And right now, you can't even discard it with any of the hand disruption, because Inquisition and Duress both miss it. So I think this guy is what Troll Ascetic is supposed to look like. I mean, granted, you can't have two in play, but...
I think that's really the saving grace, though, so you don't get into stupid mirror matches where everyone just has a stack of old trolls.
I'm the last troll. No, I'm the last troll.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I mean, Grave Titan is a pretty good guy, and Grave Titan still kind of trumps this guy.
It's a close fight. I mean, if you think comparatively, you drop this guy on 4, so by turn 6 you can regenerate. You can either choose to eat the zombies that are coming at you, or you can survive through Grave Titan. I mean, obviously they don't kill each other, but
so it's not a close fight.
It's a closer fight than usually anything compared to Grave Titan. Usually, I mean, Grave Titan is the new standard. Where it's this guy comes down, and now you have 10 power, like, 14 power. You just can't stop it. It's
like you have the troll out. They have a Grave Titan. They play the Grave Titan. You can't attack them, so you pass. They attack with everything. You block a token, take 8. Now they have 3 tokens. Or you block Grave Titan and take 4, now they have 4 tokens.
Right.
I mean, well, I guess you can Lightning Bolt the Grave Titan or something post-combat, but...
Other magic cards do exist. This guy's a shot.
Yeah, but I mean, what you want from a card is that you want it to be able to do something by itself against the cards you have to worry about. I'm not saying that this is bad against Blue-Black, because it's actually going to be very good against Blue-Black. Once you have it, like, Grave Titan is the only card in our deck that really meaningfully interacts with this guy, which is, I think, pretty important.
Okay.
So,
the bar is set really high, is what we're saying. I mean, this card looks so good already.
I mean, we're talking about a card that we want a creature that can fight Jace and Grave Titan. That's actually impossible, right? I mean, Grave Titan is the only card that comes to mind.
Great. Sable Stag?
Yeah, that's true, I guess. But Grave Titan still wins there. But
I know.
But the fact that Thrun does that and can't get countered or discarded, I mean, I think Thrun's going to be actually very good. Yeah. I mean, he's less impressive against, like, Rug or Blue-White just because, like, they have way more creatures and crap like that. And
you can't Inferno Titan it. You can't Frost Titan it. I mean,
yeah, but, like,
it's still there.
If Rug's going off with Jace, like, playing Cobras and Oracles, like, they're just going to... They can play a Chump Block every turn.
They'll go over or through it. It's not that big.
And, like, Blue-White, if you play it turn 4, they can still Dead Judgment turn 4. So.
Well, even though we've only seen, you know, 40-ish cards from the set, I would not be at all surprised if this is the most expensive rare, like, regular
rare.
It's
a Mythic, right? Or no?
I think it's just rare.
Okay, I don't
now
know.
Now you throw me for a loop. I was pretty sure it was a rare coming into the... It's not on my list. It doesn't tell me one or the other. But I think it's a rare. If that's the case, I'm pretty confident this is going to be the most expensive rare at release time and probably the most expensive rare with a long way to go.
I mean, look what it's got going for it. It's good Like, it's just like, it's going to be a very good card in the format. It's good against Jace decks, which people always like.
Which are key now.
It's also, like, really flavorful and really cool. Like, I mean, it's just a sweet card. Like,
it's not a terrible Commander General.
No, like, it hits all the high notes that cards want to hit. You know, it's fairly flashy, it's cool, it's good flavor, it's good and constructed, and it's good against the kind of decks that people want to beat. You know, Jace is the new Jund. People don't want to play it, they want to be able to beat it, so... This guy gives you options to do that.
Okay. So a few more cards to talk about. I guess we could spend a lot of time on all this trolling we're doing.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, some of the cards you put down are like pretty much limited only, but they're still kind of cool. Like,
we have...
Rotwolf.
Rotwolf. Specifically on my list of cards to talk about today because Webb is right off camera.
For
those of you that don't know, try to get more value out of your Heavy Arbalest. Just found a way.
Equip Heavy Arbalest on a Rotwolf, shoot a guy, draw a card. I mean, that's just awesome.
We can stop at this point and say, like, Infect guys look really good in this set.
The Infect guys are insane. Rotwolf, even just, like, straight up him battling a guy and you drawing a card, I mean, that's awesome.
Just fine.
There's the new Viridian Shaman of green 1/2/2 Infect Viridian Shaman.
Viridian Corruptor. Conley Woods is already, like... He's talked it not at all PG terms about how much he likes this card.
Well, okay, I can imagine that. We've also got some other like pretty good beaters.
We've already talked about Septic Rats. We talked about Spread the Plague. We've talked about a couple other. We've talked about Priests already.
Yeah.
Like it's going to be interesting. Like drafting now is initially in fact going to be overdrafted a whole bunch because pack one looks to be pretty stacked.
My hope is actually that. The reason I don't like Infect and like triple scars is that you can, if you first pick Sisbear and the guy to your right's Infect, you get cut and Sisbear doesn't work in any of the other decks. And then like green and black are pretty weak if you're not infecting. My hope is that with Besieged, there's so much Infect that Infect's just part of the draft. Like you can't get cut in Infect if it's like a ton of Infect. Like basically, I don't like Infect when it's like a small percentage, but really good if you get it. I want Infect to just like, I'd rather just be like a ton of Infect. So
you'd rather that when we draft Scars of Mirrodin, block limited, everyone starts at 10.
I mean, if that's how they're going to play it, that's how they're going to play it. I don't like it when Infect is like an all or nothing strategy where if you get the Nut Infect deck, your deck's awesome, otherwise it's bad. I'd rather just Infect just be kind of the normal strategy, like where you draft Infect creatures because that's what there are in the format.
Well, there looks to be plenty in this set.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying is like, I would rather there be 10 awesome Infect creatures than 2. Because if there's 2 awesome Infect creatures and you're the only person Infect, your deck is like very overpowered compared to everyone else's. If there's 10 awesome Infect creatures, then everyone gets some of them, and you're kind of on the same footing.
Yeah, it's nice.
And you get more interactive.
It's definitely nice to know that you won't be hosed pack one. You don't take that first pick Sisbear or this maybe a Septic Rats or something, and you know that you'll be able to get some more Infect playable cards going in the next couple.
There's that enchantment that makes a creature into an Infect guy. I mean, black and one.
We've got an Infect Lifelinker. We've got some sweet Infect rares. What a great segue here.
Oh yeah, the Vat Mother. I don't remember her first name.
She's a Phyrexian, actually. She's a Phyrexian.
Phyrexian Vat Mother of 2/2 black for 4/5 Infect, and each it's an Infect Juzum because during your upkeep, it gives you a poison counter. I mean,
seems pretty worth it.
That's exactly the kind of card I was talking about when I wanted good Infect cards. Like, this is the kind of card you can curve a Phyrexian Crusader into, and it's also just going to be good in a blue black deck, probably. Just, you know, take that, Thrun. This beats the troll quite efficiently.
We just spent 5 minutes talking about how sweet that card is. They were like, well...
This card also just trumps it, you know.
This is 4/5 for 4. They just kind of...
Straight up trumps it.
Wrecks it.
But I mean, like, imagine playing this card against, like, vampires. I mean, I know they can gatekeep it, but if they can't, it's just, like, enormous.
Yeah. Yeah. I didn't even think about that. Here I am, like, you know, it's balmy and limited. Here we are moving, like, constructed going to see Infect...
It is balmy and limited, and the thing is... This is kind of like Scytherix, but better, essentially, although it might combine well also with Scytherix, in that it's an Infect card that you can put in a deck even if there's no other Infectors and still, like, win the game with it, whereas Phyrexian Crusader is not going to, like, win the game, probably. Like, non-Infect decks that play Phyrexian Crusader are going to play him because because of his protection and first strike, whereas Infect decks can just play both and attack.
Yeah. It's one more thing to come back to that, you know, looking at Besieged Scars Limited.
Yeah.
How many of those Infect creatures are going to be playable in non-Infect decks? Because if you look at Infect creatures right now, sure, you're going to play your Necropedes and, you know.
Yeah, like in Triple Scars, like, you don't ever play a Plague Stinger in a non-Infect deck unless you're going to sideboarding it against Infect. Sisbear is okay because it's okay blocker, but like Contagious Nim, like, these aren't the kind of cards you want in your non-Infect decks. But any Infect guy with 3 or more power finishes the game fast enough by himself that you're fine playing it. Like, I played Tel'Jalad Fallen because it was protection and 3 power in non-Infect decks. you're going to play this 4-5 in non-infect decks, or the 7-7 Hydra that has infect and reverse infect, that all the damage dealt to him,
yes,
you know,
that
is encounters.
That's a Phyrexian Hydra. That's another card we could stop on. Not quite as impressive to me as the Vat Mother, but...
No, not getting constructed at all, but...
seven power infect guy with no inherent...
You would play that in any green deck in Limited because it kills them in two hits, like, very easily.
Yeah.
So...
All right, let's see if there's any more infect guys on my list. That might be it since we're on the subject.
Well, it's like I recalled that whole list very, very well.
There's a few still on here, actually.
I'm sure there are.
Well, let's stop by Sphere of the Suns, actually. Talking about cards that might work with a new Tezzeret, or just kind of
I mean, the coming to play tap signet that only you can lose three times, the gemstone signet.
it's kind of like Cold Steel Heart with charge counters or something like that.
It's like gemstone mine, because once you run out of charge counter, it doesn't do anything.
All right.
Except it stays in play for... Tezzeret to like
to 5-5 it up and get in there.
But I mean, curving out, like, now we actually have a artifact way to curve out into a turn 3 Jace or a turn 3 Tezzeret, which is pretty sweet.
And then, you know, so play this on turn 2, turn 3 Tezzeret, turn 4, you know, power something else out or make it a 5-5.
Yeah, I mean, there's like a dedicated control deck that's going to want to tap its mana sources a ton of times over the course of a game probably doesn't want this. Like, for example, blue-black, I don't think is going to be a fan of this card, just because the fact that it adds colored mana is not nearly enough to make it better than Everflowing Chalice.
You know, with everyone playing like 12 to 16 dual lands anyway, like, their color shouldn't be too big.
You don't want to run out of it, because once you run out, it doesn't do anything. But in an artifact deck, which not only is going to have a lower curve, it's also going to have ways to make use of it when it runs out, like animating it and whatnot, I could see it being pretty good, especially if you want to play like three colors or something like that, since blue-black and white seem like the natural fit for artifacts, because those are the artifact colors.
Definitely extended, but we'll see how it rolls out in standard. I mean,
yeah,
you know, there's no like open the vaults, there's no Esper S cards, but it definitely seems like it fits that color combination right now.
Yeah.
What also fits with artifacts pretty well seems like Shimmer Mirror.
In Limited, yeah. In Constructed, no.
This seems like a casual dream, right?
Well, it's a sweet card. I really like the picture. Like, it's like this Quicksilver Mirror dodging through a bunch of Phyrexians, and It has flash, and all your artifacts have flash.
Yeah, so, you know, it seems like in Commander, you just bring that guy down, then bring down your Fidel Canori, and then everything comes down.
Seems like a pretty good deal.
Yeah, I mean, in Limited, he obviously seems pretty good. And
yeah, 3-mana, 2-2 flash, you'd probably play as an artifact just because for value. Yeah.
Instant Metalcraft.
Yeah, and instant speed Metalcraft, block your, you know, 1-1 attacker or whatever.
Right.
But in giving your other things instant equip, or instant... speed is pretty sweet, like Rusted Relic block.
That's a good one. Yeah, anything along those lines. That guy's pretty sweet. I think that about brings us to the end of this list.
Yeah, we're getting there. We've got, you know, only like less than 2 weeks away from the pre-release. At this point, like, we're looking forward to seeing what else we see. Hopefully there's enough artifacts to make a sweet artifact deck. Tezzeret, Sphere of the Suns, both seem like they're good. Phyrexian Revoker. These are the kind of cards I'd be looking to put in like aggressive / combo-ish blue-black artifact deck. So we'll see what else we get, because it'd be pretty nice to have an actual artifact deck in standard.
Yeah. I mean, we are in Mirrodin block again, and it took a little while for it to happen the first time around.
I mean, I'm not surprised we don't get another affinity, but I still think we can get a sweet artifact deck that will just be fun to play.
Anything that puts new decks into the meta, that's what I'm looking for.
Yeah. Well, we'll see. We'll see very soon.
And we'll have plenty more cards when we come back next week.
Yep. Thanks for watching.
I ain't scared.
You guys ready?
I can't even get any of this area. Like, look at how hard it is for you. I was going to say, this is exactly comfortable.
All right.
Put a grin on his face.
At least you're not having the churro buffet.
Ha 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 ha.